976-9741-347-326. 9741. I believe you now should know who I am. Brian the Butcher Brown. And of course, BillBrown1. What's up, brother?
Hey there, hi there, ho there.
What's going on? What's going on? Tenacious D to start the show.
I heard that. That was
sure.
That was quite the rock out right there, you know.
Rocking your fucking socks off. That's because there's a what do you call it? Tenacious D's coming out with a new album in May, so I figured, what the hell? Let's throw a little tribute out there.
Really? It's only been what, like 10 years between albums or something like that? I mean, geez.
Absolutely. But it's called The Rise of the Phoenix, so obviously they're ready to take over the rock world once again.
Yeah,
so.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So.
Yes.
So what do we have going on for tonight, kids?
I don't know, because my mouse doesn't seem to be working too well, as the whole intro got screwed up here. Because, you know, this great system we have, you know, I got to press buttons at a certain timed fashion or else they don't really go off. So, you know, I might just say fuck it at some point and, you know, give up.
And pass out
the
on the
off
thing.
Button. Yeah. Plus my ass exploded before we went on air. So I, if I have to run to the bathroom again.
Are you currently hovering over a bedpan? Is that what's your current plan of action right now? You've got a pot sitting under your chair.
I had a chamber pot. That would help out quite a bit because just in case there is an accident, it would work out tremendously. But since I don't have that, I'm taking a gamble, and I've got my shorts on, and I'm sitting in my chair. So I'm hoping that I just don't all of a sudden start spewing out from each pant leg some brown gooey mess and then be very, very disenfranchised with myself.
That's terrible. We're gonna have to bring over a portable potty seat for you. You know, like the things that almost look like a granny walker, only it's got a shit seat in it. You know, so we're just
maybe
gonna have
be like
to
one
bring
of those big fatties that end up getting grafted to those things because they never leave.
They just sit there and wait for somebody to change their waist out while they continue to put stuff in through the other hole.
Oh my God, Jesus!
They sit
Christ.
There and they watch Judge Judy and Maury. You know, well, just shove shit down their cake hole, wait for it to come out the other end, and some poor soul has to, you know, come in once a week to make sure they're not sitting over their own filth constantly.
Wow, it's perfect. Or maybe they just do sit over their own filth constantly. You know, I mean, there have been quite a few stories that have come out where, you know, the person just was like, well, you know, I just go in and give them their dinner and then leave. You know.
And that's how they end up grafted to the couch. So, you know, we're suddenly skin and fabric just start to weave together because the person just never moves.
Yeah, well, you know, I guess I could become one of those people if I'm so lucky. And then we can get a nice little story about me and get the name out there. And, you know, I'll be famous, not for any good reasons, but, you know.
Yeah. You'll be famous for them needing to bring in a backhoe to carry you out of the house.
Oh, God, that is terrible. That is terrible. Terrible, terrible. So what's new with you, Meng? Huh? How was your week?
Oh, it was all right, you know, not too bad. The job is so far boring, you know, nothing's going on in it. So, yeah, you know, a lot of sitting around. Right now I'm bleary-eyed because I spent 8 hours reading a book instead of actually doing any actual work. So, which to some people would sound amazing that, you know, you're collecting a paycheck, you just sit there and read. But guess what? Not so fun. Not so fun. You
absolutely
know, so, you know, I'd much rather be busy during the day than sitting around wondering how I'm going to fill the hours. I literally cracked this book open yesterday, and I'm done with it already. That's how much free time I have today. Yeah.
See, I can't do that. I can't do that because that would involve reading, which I'm not a huge fan of. So I'm going to have to say
there are doubts that you're even able to. So, you know, there's some people who would contend, you know, that you don't actually have the capacity. But I know better. You know,
sometimes you need
the occasional help, like in Dumb and Dumber, you know, where, you know, you're trying to sound out. But, you know, you get through it. So,
yeah. Well, you know. geez, you know, that's a little under the, below the belt, and I don't appreciate it. as you know, we didn't introduce Scott Steve from Modesto because, once again, much like he's the Nick Frank, except, you know, he just doesn't even call to say he's not going to show, so he gets... And this, and he's fired. He's definitely
fired from the band.
So. Yeah, he's cut out from the billions of dollars that's going to flow through in the next couple weeks. So he's done.
Oh, that's it. Yeah.
So
don't mind me. No cut for him. Oh well.
No cut for him. So we'll see how this goes tonight because I might cut out early if my ass explodes. Plus, I'm not feeling all that great. So. You know, I'm sure everybody out there really gives a fuck, but, you know.
Yeah, that's it. Fans will be clamoring, going, oh, my God, I did not get my fill of the Butcher Block. If
well,
we
the
go
thing
darker,
is, I just figured I'd start it up, put it on so I could keep my perfect attendance record, so I could still have that as bragging rights for something. But, you know, my mouse is absolutely driving me crazy and not working. So... You know, I can't hit things and stuff the way I want to, and that is going to be a fucking problem.
Well, I know back in like high school, you know, that sometimes, I mean, even though, you know, I wasn't quite the ruckus causer that you were, I was actually called out for my attendance a couple times because I had a lot of absences that were explained, but I still had a lot of absences. I was never actually told, you know, in order to graduate, you need to make sure you finish the rest of the year. But somebody did tell me, I was taken into the office at least once that said, look, you know, you really only have like maybe one or two absences left before you have to repeat the year. So, you know, make them count, you know, that kind of thing.
Sure.
But I do know that, you know, because then I had to ask, okay, so what actually constitutes, you know, attendance? Like if I come in the morning. Or if I come in late, you know, how many hours do I have to be actually in school for it to have counted, you know? So how long do we actually have to be on the air for it to count for that you actually
–
15 minutes?
We're close.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, 15
we're about
minutes.
Halfway there.
Well, I'm already counting it down because if I go to try to hit another button and my mouse doesn't fucking move for whatever reason, I'm just shutting it down because I just can't fucking – this
is your mouse wired or wireless?
It's wireless, and no, it's not the batteries.
It's not the batteries? Oh,
no.
Okay.
No.
All right. Okay. Hey, I was trying to solve your technical issues, you know. But.
Yeah, I hear you. I hear you. So we'll see what happens. But now after all that rambling, I guess maybe we'll talk some MMA. I don't know. We'll see how it goes. But, you know, I guess we'll start out with steroids.
Sounds
you know, because that's a big deal. I don't know if you've heard about Alistair Overeem and him failing his recent drug test. And, you know, he's got a hearing going on coming up on April 26th. But to update everybody, because I'm sure they're interested, remember one dominant female fighter named Christiane Cyborg Santos? Well, she went in front of the board, and her steroid appeal was denied. So... Mm. We'll have to, you know.
We'll have to suffer through not having to see her dick on screen during a female fight for at least a year. So I don't know how I'm going to be able to, you know, I mean, in other news, you know, transgendered females can now enter the Miss Universe contest. So I guess it's okay for Cyborg Santos to be fighting chicks, you know. So that's,
absolutely.
That's all right.
Absolutely.
You know?
The precedence has been set, and therefore it is all okay. I don't know. Forgive me. I'm just not feeling well. I'm really in a fog here.
Okay.
But, all right. I don't know.
So,
what do you want to talk about, brother? Anything?
I mean, the Alistair Overeem thing is interesting because apparently Chael Sonnen had sort of weighed in on how how it was a little messed up that, you know, that he that Alistair pissed hot at a random drug test. So the random Twitter war of the week apparently is Mr. Jason Mayhem Miller decided
Absolutely.
To blow up Twitter saying Chael berating someone on their test level is like me making fun of someone's bad haircut. Because
he's got a point.
while it is ridiculous that Alistair Overeem had 14 times the normal amount of testosterone in his blood, do you happen to know what the number is that Shale pissed hot at?
I'm not 100% sure. Correct me if I'm wrong, because I'm probably going to overestimate it, because I know I did know it at one time. But just so everybody knows, this guy who's pointing fingers at Alistair Overeem, I believe he tested, correct me, 19 to 1? Am I wrong about this?
You only overshot it by a couple. It was 17 to 1, okay? And that was on a fight night, okay? He pissed hot the night they were fighting, okay? So that, all right, it's not, now, I mean, a commentator by the name of Mike Schiavello was on some radio show this week talking about how he thought it was ridiculous that everybody was all up in arms about the test results because, because he pissed hot 2 months before the fight, not like he pissed hot, on fight night, that kind of thing. That was his whole point, hey, if he tested 14-1 on fight night, then I'd understand why everybody's so mad. But, 2 months before the fight, that's kind of ridiculous. Which is hysterical because, cheating is cheating no matter what. The random drug test, if it it's basically the same as, having a high result on fight night.
Absolutely.
So it was pretty funny that Mayhem decides to try to take Chael down a notch. However, Chael, as he is known to do, fires back with probably, what I consider the absolute A-bomb as far as what he could have possibly said in response to Mayhem's little quip. He says, at Mayhem, due to time constraints, I am currently confining my Twitter wars to active, relevant fighters only. Buy a t-shirt on your way out.
And, Chael is 100% correct, and I am kind of a Mayhem fan, but he really did look like dog shit in that fight against Bisping. So, Mayhem was absolutely right to comment on the fact that a guy who tested 17-1 on his testosterone ratio to sit there and call out another guy. But then again, that is quite an atom bomb for Chael to throw back because, he really didn't look like he belonged, not just in the UFC, but I'd say even in, a Rage in the Cage. A man didn't look like he could hold his own.
Yeah. Or Ultimate Challenge MMA. But it seems like everybody's sort of weighing in on this in some way. Mark Hunt, who there's this big groundswell of support for him now to take Alistair's place in the title fight. He basically, went on to say that, nothing that Overeem's done at this point means anything now because of this. And he qualified it by saying, he's like, he says, no, I'm not saying the guy's a bad fighter. It's just that everything he's done and everything he will do is now going to be, is now going to be tainted by this.
Sure.
When he
it already
beat
was.
Me back,
we knew what was going on.
Yeah. When he beat me in Dream, was he juicing? Nobody knows. But now you got to wonder, did he beat me clean or did he beat me, when he was cheating? So everything he does now is going to be subject to debate.
I'm going to let Mark Hunt in on a little secret. Since it was in Japan, over in Dream, I'm going to say this, that he was juiced out of his motherfucking mind when he went into that ring and pummeled Mark Hunt, okay? Because they're not exactly known for their testing. It's very rare over there, and I don't think they're going to take a guy with the superstar name of Alistair Overeem and sit there and risk having a positive test on him because, they selectively do that in Japan.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, just so that they can say that they're not completely unregulated. But, we all know that, it's pretty much, no holds barred over there. You could literally be walking out to the ring with the needle shoved in your ass, and they probably wouldn't say you cheated. So,
absolutely.
I mean, hell, that's where, what's his face? Our other favorite juicer, spent most of his time after he was.
The War Master? Listen, I think the War Master just has a little bit of a bad name, okay? I think for the most part, everybody's out to get him. When he took the title from Randy Couture way back in the day and then the UFC was really pissed at him, he only had, I believe, four different banned substances in his system after he took the title from Randy.
Only
so I don't know why everybody's got to fucking kick Josh Barnett in the nuts and act like he's up to no good all the time.
Oh, man. But,
four
yeah,
different
so Mark...
steroid metabolites showed up when he beat Randy all those years ago.
So Mark Hunt's weighed in on it. Ken Florian, you know, basically everybody has some sort of opinion on what's going on here. So I don't know. I mean, we talked about it last week about how, and the week before about how
sure.
It was pretty much awful for the card and awful for the sport in general, and that it's just, you know, good that nobody else tested positive for it. But I mean, Dana said that, you know, cause we had discussed who we would like to see, step in there. The Mir versus, Velasquez is still going on. So obviously that's not happening.
That's not getting blown up. I mean, we spoke about it briefly. Not briefly, I guess we talked about it in depth on Monday's show too. There's an old man trying to throw his hat in the ring, and that might be the guy on the fast track in there, you know. Mr. Dan Henderson, he's looking and itching. He's thrown his hat in the ring and said he would definitely step in there and fight Junior Dos Santos. So,
I don't know if that's a good idea at all. Don't get me wrong. You know, I mean, Hendo is a warrior, and you know, I like watching him fight. But
so it'd be like an iceberg trying to attack Dos Santos, though.
Well, not only that, I mean, he's at a complete size disadvantage because, I mean, Hendo, you know, he bounced back and forth between middleweight and light heavyweight, okay? And,
yeah.
I mean, he was kind of on the, you know, mid-size for the light heavy division, okay? So, I mean, I don't know, you know, even if he managed to get up to 225, I think he would be, you know.
He knocked Bader the fuck out. He was weighing in at a fucking hefty 212, I believe, that fight.
Yes, he did. He did. He did, you know, put down the Last Emperor, which is another name they love throwing into the mix for this fight against JDS. But everybody loves to forget that, aside from the fact that Dana really loves to piss all over the Fedor thing because of the number of times, you know, that they haven't come to a deal just because of the co-promotion thing. But Fedor is already scheduled to fight somebody in June. Okay.
Absolutely. Well, they don't have an opponent yet, though. He's just contracted, which is just M1 setting up a show with Fedor's name on it, you know.
I don't know. I guess it could conceivably happen, but, you know, I don't think so. You know.
Well, did you listen to the Monday show?
I did.
Did you, brother? Did you? Well, my theory with I think they should just fucking scrap that hideous, you know, heavyweight tournament over in Strikeforce and just grab good old Josh Barnett and give him a chance here, you know? That's what I think.
Well, yeah, I mean, because obviously – you know, the heavyweight Grand Prix for Strikeforce has just been a complete shit show from the beginning. And now, because there's only Josh Barnett and
Cormier,
you know, only Barnett and Cormier are pretty much the only two heavyweights left in Strikeforce.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think I see what you're saying, but I think they kind of need to have a payoff for the Strikeforce Heavyweight Grand Prix before they just decide to bring Barnett over. You know, as it is, they've completely cannibalized that roster to the point where there's nobody really relevant over there. You know, I think they've got Barnett and my brain's not working tonight. What's his face?
Wait, I missed what you said. I'm sorry. I was fucking looking at
They've only got two relevant fighters over in Strikeforce right now. Barnett and I think he's the lightweight champ over there, or no?
Oh, Gilbert Melendez.
Yeah, they've got Gilbert Melendez and Josh Barnett and a bunch of tomato cans. And, you know, and basically the chicks that are, you know, that's all that they've got over in Strikeforce. So I think that they have to have a payoff on the Strikeforce Grand Prix just because You know, they were hyping it so much, and now it is down to just the title fight, you know, to all of a sudden say, yeah, you know what, the hell with it. At this stage in the game, you know, just would really spell the end of that entire, you know, promotion. I know that's one of the things that we keep talking about anyway, that they should fold those tents.
Just or destroy
just completely,
it.
You know, or just completely change the focus. But, you know, I think that they'd end up, you know, I think the whole reason why Gil is still over there languishing in that hell, and the fact that they're still toying with the idea of, you know, that they're still saying that they're going to finish the heavyweight Grand Prix is because of whatever contract negotiations that they had with Showtime, you know, that they had to at least pretend that they're trying to have a viable promotion over there.
Oh, absolutely. Well, that's, you know, why Gil got stuck, because they fucking put their foot down. And but the thing is I don't know why Gil signed the contract he signed when the writing was on the wall. He should have been smarter and signed a shorter contract, because as great as he is, you know, now he's just complaining that, you know, he wants to fight a big UFC name and nobody seems receptive to it. But I think, you know, he's partially to blame. I think he signed the contract, I guess, out of good faith, but, you know, he only what ended up happening is he hurt himself.
Yeah. He ended up getting trapped over there. But no, I mean, it's sort of, you know, it's sort of unfortunate that they have nothing going on over there at all. So they only have Gil and this heavyweight Grand Prix, and then that's it, you know, and I guess Ronda Rousey. But again, you know, as we discussed before, I really don't know how you build an entire product around that. I mean, obviously Invicta's going to try, but...
some ladies out there that they could go after to do that, but, you know, it's still not a viable. They definitely don't want to tie money up in that. That's for sure.
No, definitely not. They'll let Invicta lay the groundwork, like we've said before, and if it ever becomes you know, a viable option, they'll either buy Invicta or start cannibalizing their roster. One or the other. So
absolutely. So here's what I would like to see happen. You know, I mean, now I'm gonna get away from Gil and the Strikeforce thing, but I know that's probably not gonna happen. I just wanted to bring that up because, like I said, on Monday, with the thing with Josh Barnett is I wanted to be a guy to finally start a rumor, and you know, I've done no legwork since that. Like, I could have went on like the message boards and stuff like that and tried to fucking get this thing going, but you know, I'm too lazy and I didn't do it, but. It would be interesting because I know they've definitely warmed up enough to Barnett to say that if he wins the tournament, he's definitely going to come over to the UFC. But, you know, he's still got to beat Cormier, which I think he will. That shouldn't be a problem for him. But, you know, the solution isn't an easy one. They're waiting until after that hearing to see who they're going to – what's the next course of action? Because Overeem obviously has got a defense. He's got a whole defense team. And, you know, as much as, like, you brought up that Chevallo guy who, you know, he's a really good friend of Overeem, so what the fuck else was he going to say? You know, but to sit there and take the stance that, you know, cheating's all right as long as you don't get caught, which, let me tell you something, I'd be a hypocrite to say I didn't agree with the guy, because I've said it with all the baseball shit that's gone on with the Balco thing and, you know, with fucking everybody, oh, it's so tainted, these records. First off, guess what, people? Back in the day when Babe Ruth was fucking around and everything, he was a fucking cheater too. You know, all those guys, whatever was available to them at the time to cheat, they did it. They might not have had the designer fucking steroids to do it, but they were finding ways to cheat, okay? So it's really just the modern age of cheating, and everybody's going to look to get ahead. So I'd be a hypocrite to say that I didn't agree partially with Schiavallo, but of course, when you're on a national radio show, and everybody's sitting there, and it is a big issue, and it's really against the rules to say, yeah, but it's 2 months out, and he has 14-1 ratio. He could definitely be 6-1 by fight time. He's probably right, because Overeem knows how to cycle. But at the same time, it's not exactly the what everybody wants to hear, and they're certainly not going to agree with it. But the other point that he brought up was, and I think this is where Overeem does kind of have a case as well, even though he said he was going to agree with the Nevada State Athletic Commission with the whole random drug testing thing, with the whole Brock Lesnar fiasco thing when he fucking beat feet and ran out of the country. I believe he swam across the Atlantic to get away from that fucking drug test. You know, that's how quick he needed to get out. He couldn't even get on a plane. But you know, he did agree. He knew that these guys were gunning for him. You know, the NSAC definitely, probably even before that incident with Brock Lesnar, because, you know, as we've joked around about it before he got signed to the UFC, that the guy's a steroid freak, even though he's never tested positive for it, yada, 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 and all the horse meat jokes and everything like that. The NSAC, I guarantee you, when he was originally going to fight Brock Lesnar, they were like, well, we're really going to have to fucking, you know, put his piss test through the gamut if there's an extra step you can do in there that maybe they don't do with other fighters, which is kind of probably, you know, I'm making that up. I have no proof that they would have done that, you know, put it through extra testing or not. But just because of all the rumors, then he pulls that stunt and they say, well, we'll give you a conditional license, but you got to, you know, subject yourself to random drug testing. So I don't know where in his fucking mind that he thought, you know what, I'm going to, you know, go through my usual cycles. And then when I go to Nevada for the press conference, that this might not happen, you know. He should have been looking, you know, he should have been very suspicious as soon as he stepped on American soil, you know, that he might be fucking piss tested. But,
yeah.
You know, I really got away from the point that I was going to try to make. But the thing that Shivala said is that since he's not licensed, there's this governing body has no power over him to even ask for a piss test. You know what I'm saying? So this could be the loophole that is going to be his defense when he comes up to that hearing, because even though, of course, the naysayer, only the real Overeem fans that hang off his nuts are going to go, yeah, this is great, he's going to fight. Now everybody else, you know, is still going to sit there, and that motherfucker is going to be booed out of the fucking stadium if that's the defense that he takes and they go for it, because, you know, I see the guy's point there. You know, who are they to step up to this guy and say, hey, you got to piss in this cup, when he isn't licensed by them? It's another thing when you are under that license, you're under their jurisdiction, you're under their rules. You have to, you know, subject yourself to it. You know, that's why when he did the Brock Lesnar thing, he was coming up to applying for his license, and then that all fucking happened. And then, you know, he ran away. So I think the guy has the point there. And like I said, I'd be a hypocrite if I didn't agree with some of his points. But, you know, it's just some things that you can and can't say, because there's no way people are going to agree with you and go, yeah, he can cheat when, as long as he doesn't get caught.
Mm-hmm. That's essentially what it is, though. You know, I mean, it sounds like it might be a sound legal loophole, but, you know, at the end of the day, it's still cheating.
Absolutely.
You know, whether you're doing it in such a way that by the time fight night comes, you know, it's either out of your system or down to acceptable levels so that, you know, you're not going to fail the drug test. It's a banned substance. It's not considered legal by any of the governing bodies. You know, to use it is an advantage, you know, over people who don't use it at all. So, you know, how do you level the playing field? You know, if people are just taking advantage of the timetables and when you naturally pass it out of your system, then they've basically got a leg up on everybody who doesn't do it. So, if you use it at any point, it's still you're still cheating. So I don't know. It's just basically, you know, using the system to get away with it. And
of course,
which while you said, yeah, fine, you know, that might be what gets him out of it. But do I like it? No, not at all. No. You know, I'd actually rather him. Yeah, because yes, he's not licensed by the Nevada State Athletic Commission, so they can't actually punish him, but they can refuse him a license.
Oh,
know?
Absolutely.
So, I mean, essentially, it's the same thing as getting a suspension. You know, they can't fine him or anything like that, but, you know, they can basically make sure that he doesn't fight.
That's pretty much is going to happen.
Yeah, exactly. And pretty much any other athletic commission in the country is probably not going to grant him one either, you know. So then what's his option? To wait until somebody, you know, will license him, or to basically break the unwritten rule, which is sort of frowned upon if he decides to go to a country that's on, you know, and fight there in the meantime. While, you know,
like Texas. They'll license anybody.
Well, then, you know what? Then all's forgiven. Dana's just going to have to, you know, schedule all his fights for Texas. So
Sure, of course. But then, you know, of course, he knows people are going to be doing things to get around it. But I don't know. It's definitely a, like, I've made fun of the guy and everything. Like, whatever. The guy fucking uses steroids. The guy uses steroids. But the fact of the matter is like, to go with kind of what you were saying, if everybody was cycling on and off of it, there should have been at least one other guy popped there. So, you know, and Bigfoot Silva has been popped before in the past, so obviously he learned from that and said, fuck it, I ain't using him. Because, you know, if the guy was guilty before, why wouldn't he be cycling now? So, you know, unless these other guys, you know, were given a heads up, which I doubt it, because nobody would have kept their mouth shut. Somebody would have told the ream, and he would have never showed up for the press conference, you know.
Yeah.
So, he would have been sick that day or something, you know. But, you know, I don't know. I don't know how they're going to fix it, but, you know, I definitely don't see Fedor, because I don't think Dana has. He even said, I think a month ago, the door is officially shut on Fedor for him forever, you know. And to be quite honest, he flopped hugely when he came over here to fight in the States. You know, he got off to a good start, and then, of course, he lost, what, 3 in a row to end his career in Strikeforce, so... And then they just released him. They had one more fight. He was contracted to one more fight, and they said, fuck it, you know. We don't even want that fight anymore. So
we don't need it. Goodbye.
Yeah. And so I don't think there's any interest in Fedor filling in there, you know. Plus, like I said, he's M1's got him scheduled for June, and possibly Halls Gracie is going to be fighting him. So,
you know,
that's up in the air. So I don't see him... So it's going to have to be something internal, and like I said, it might be that old fucking iceberg trying to maneuver his way around the ring towards a very fast Junior Dos Santos. What is this? The abortion that is ultimate ball. The abortion that is ultimate ball.
Mm-hmm.
What is this?
This is the next thing that I actually wanted to bring up. Apparently, over the weekend, in a promotion that I've never heard of.
Oh, I think I know what this is. Go on,
Ultimate
though.
Challenge MMA. Apparently, one of the things that they had on their fight card was the subject of this video. And
they use tasers, Billy?
They don't use tasers.
Damn it! All right,
but
not what I'm thinking.
It's essentially it takes place in a ring, a cage, and there's two nets on either side of the cage. And there's two teams of five. And it's basically like a very cramped rugby game with guys wearing fucking, the 6 ounce gloves. So they're allowed to punch each other and kick each other and slam each other while trying to get this ball from one side of the ring to the other and score goals. And it is, I swear to God, dude. And I mean, it's only 5 minutes long. But, I mean, it is, I just do not know. This is like something that I would expect them to pull in fucking, on wrestling, on in the WWE.
Sure.
Somebody would be like, hey, you know, let's come up with a sport and where the guys can, you know, beat the shit out of each other while they're trying to score goals. You know, and it would be like one of those gimmick things. It'd be like one of those gimmick things that they put on during a random pay-per-view, you know, to have guys who aren't actually on the roster, you know. But it's ridiculous. It's obviously some ham and egger fighters that they decided to throw $50 a piece to. And, you know, just to go in there and play this stupid half soccer, half rugby abortion that they get to slam each other. And what I find hysterical is, you know, because this, you know, this is in England, this event took place.
Well, of course it
is. But, you know, the limey commentator is acting like it's the most amazing thing he's ever seen. And, you know, but he's completely overselling it. And, you know, he just keeps talking about, oh, I just want to see somebody throw a punch. Because what it devolved into was like almost football. You know, like the guy who had the ball would end up getting friggin', you know, taken down as somebody ripped the ball out of his hands and, you know, tried to score a goal. And
nice.
I just, you know, I mean, if this is going to be their gimmick,
number five is a fucking behemoth.
Yeah, but it's ridiculous. I mean, first of all, you know, the playing field is literally, what, like 15 feet across? So, you know, you need to take three steps in order to get from one goal to another. Now, granted, you have, you know, five opposing dudes looking to punch your head off, you know, between the two goals, but it's just so stupid. I just don't understand.
Stupid,
like,
or amazing? You know, this is fucking... Oh, this guy stinks. He just fucking got intercepted. I'm a douche.
Later on in the video, the one team is going to score by basically punching a deflection. Okay.
Yeah, I've seen it already.
You saw that already?
It's awesome. Yeah. Yeah, the dude just put his fucking arm up, not even realizing that the stupid rugby ball or whatever the hell it's called was going to be there, and just it bounced off his fucking hand and went into the goal, and they were all rejoicing over this.
This is so stupid. It's like something that you see on American Gladiators.
Bum, 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 bum. That's exactly what it is. Holy shit. Where's fucking Storm and Nitro? They should come running out and fucking show these assholes how it's done.
These guys are attempting no-look passes, and the only problem is that unless you're in the NBA, you know, most of the time nobody's there.
Well, I'm going to say that the black guys in the cage probably will be fine with the no-look passes.
You're right. The few that completely whiffed were done by white dudes. So.
Yeah, exactly. You know? It's like the white guys playing on the Harlem Globetrotters. It just doesn't work.
I mean, seriously, I've never even heard of Ultimate Challenge MMA, but this is seriously, is this something that they're going to do? Like, on all of their fight cards, this is going to be the original thing that puts them over the top?
I hope so.
Ultimate ball on every card?
I hope they are. Oh, wow, that dude fucking, he like, kicked at the one guy, so that's pretty cool. No, I hope that they do, because... This if they put this on every fight card, it'll show that the UCMMA is definitely ready for the fucking big time. UFC, look out, they're coming. You better just fucking turn it over to them right now. Why bother competing? Because once this shit hits this shore, everybody's gonna be fucking clamoring for it. So it's gonna be amazing. Yeah, I think that's one of like 1, 2, 3, 4. I think it's 8-sided. I think. That's like a little bit smaller than a regular octagon that they're playing in.
Oh,
I think
okay.
The octagon's, what, 30 by 30?
Maybe.
I'm pretty
yeah,
sure.
I mean, yeah, this ring looks like slightly smaller than the UFC's ring. So, you know, not too much. But, you know, I think it's about the size of the WEC ring because that was a little smaller than,
oh,
you
okay,
know,
maybe that's what it is.
I think that's why, you know, to get off to sort of get off on a tangent for a little bit. I think that might be why some of the WEC guys, a couple of them anyway, aren't quite as dominant as they were because there's more real estate.
Yeah.
You know, for
such
people to
little,
run
little
to.
Men, those little legs in there just can't fucking run, get through the
can't close the distance enough.
No, not at all. Fucking shit. No, the ultimate ball. It's called. I think this is
yeah,
the shit,
ultimate
dude.
Ball.
In 1993, they said the UFC will never take off. Look at it now. Ultimate ball is the sport of the future. This is just an MMA ad on this. This is a new sport in its own right. I agree.
Ultimate ball is the wave of the future. You agree?
Well, absolutely. But nobody believes us. Just check it out because it is amazing. You know, I mean... When's the next Ultimate Ball match? Because that's all I want to talk about on this show from now on. This is going to be called
Ultimate Ball
on the Butcher Block. Yeah. You know, I'm going to fucking have our first fantasy draft this weekend for Ultimate Ball players because, you know, nobody else is doing it. And we certainly don't really, especially when there's a lull in events, we don't really get so much fantasy MMA talk. So this will be the fill for it, Fantasy Ultimate Ball. And I think it's going to be taking the world by storm. It's pretty fucking cool. Now, I'm glad you shared that, Billy. I'm glad you shared that. But I know this has nothing at all to do with what was just going on, but I've got a treat for you.
Okay.
And possibly a treat for the whole world. And then, you know, I'll get into a little discussion after this, but I just want to start it out with this. Right.
the mud. Fighter gotta fight for the opportunity. Gotta beat the fear, fight the victory. Fighter gotta raise his hand. Fighter gotta take that chance. Fighter gotta be paid of adrenaline. Fighter gotta win, fighter gotta win, fighter gotta win.
I told you I was gonna get the fucking clip eventually. I told
that
you.
That is so awesomely bad.
Yes, it is amazing. I've been dying. I've been dying to play this like the last fucking 5 weeks that we've been doing this show, maybe even longer. Okay, and somehow nobody out there on the fucking internet has made a goddamn MP3 of this yet. So I had to do it myself. All right, and I am not a computer wizard. I don't know sorcery. Of course, what I had to do is I had to text Dean, okay? And, which, obviously, once I did this today and I texted him, I was like, why am I an idiot and I didn't ask this question fucking 5 weeks ago, you know? Because it said I was just doing searches for Super Fight League Anthem MP3s and nobody had it anywhere. But now we got it, and anybody who wants to get it from me, that would be $59.99, thank you very much, okay? I know I didn't write it. I'm not part of the Super Fight League. But they didn't put an MP3 out that people could illegally download on it. Okay. So I've done everybody service here. I'm very happy with this. And don't mind me. I'm going to keep playing it over and over again because I figure we might maybe talk a little bit about Super Fight League. You know? We had an event this past Saturday. Which, you know, was obviously a little bit better caliber of fighters than the first one. And they've already announced their third one. But Todd Duffy, former UFC fighter, he was the main event. And he fucking finally got his first win in 2 years. Getting his back 10-2. Took 34 seconds to dispose of Neil Grove in the main event. And it was pretty impressive performance. And you know what? I'm hoping this league succeeds. From what I have watched it, because I watched the whole first card, I watched the second card in bits and pieces because I forgot Saturday morning that it was on. I think they're legitimately trying, with the exception of this ridiculous song, they're trying really, really, really hard to put something together. And they've obviously got some of the buku. They must be in the upper class up there in India because these guys who are running this thing got some big, big bucks. So I think this thing has viable income behind it that they could definitely keep going, and it looks like they're trying to put together an exciting card. But did you catch any action from the Super Fight League this past weekend?
You know what? I totally forgot that it was on this weekend as well. But I did. I actually watched the first match about an hour before we went on the air.
nice. Hey, whatever. I didn't watch it all either. I only looked at some highlights and the Todd Duffy fight because it was short and the chick fight I looked at.
Well, yeah, I mean, as I was paging through some of the websites that I looked for, you know, to try and steal their material to then pass it off as my own, I was reminded that, yeah, the Super Fight League 2 had happened, this past weekend. So, you know, I immediately ran over to YouTube to start taking a look at clips, and then was upset that the very first one that I looked at, you know, was a 25-minute long clip. And I was like, oh, no, I don't know if I can deal with this. And, the fight itself was pretty good. It was between Ryan Healy and Paul Kelly.
I got somehow disconnected already. I don't know what's going on with anything. I apologize. So I hope you weren't throwing anything over to me.
Oh, no.
Okay, good.
I didn't even notice you were gone. But basically, well, you know how I am. I just, you know, run off at the mouth for about a half an hour. And then when I run out of stuff to say, I wait for you to cut me off. Was just saying that, you know, I had totally forgotten that it was on, and decided to start looking up clips, about an hour before we went on the air. So I only really got to watch the first fight, which was Ryan Healy versus Paul Kelly.
Okay.
And you know, the in-fight action, you know, the in-the-ring, which, by the way, speaking of cages, that cage is enormous, by the way. I mean, I think I would get winded walking from one side of the ring to the other. Perfectly.
Is it round? Is it round?
It's round. Why? Yeah.
Because if you remember, the Elite XC cage was round, and it looked fucking tremendous.
Yeah, I don't know why that is. Like, if, you know, you can't build it with angles, all of a sudden it's got to be, you know, the size of a damn swimming pool.
Yeah.
You know, but yeah, it was, you know, the fight itself was great. What was absolutely painful was listening to the commentary.
Come on, don't fucking do Baroni like this. I love it because he's an idiot.
Baroni is terrible. I mean, I don't even know the other guy who's with him. But it seems like he's constantly throwing things to Baroni, trying to give him a chance to weigh in on stuff. And half the time, it seems like Baroni is really racking his brain to come up with something to say, you know, because, you know, I think the dude threw it over to him for the, you know, the highlights of the first round.
Right.
And Baroni half the time, you know, it's like he's sitting there going, oh, there's a nice over the elbow and some dirty boxing there, and there's a kick and some more dirty boxing, and there's a takedown that ended the round, and it totally was not the takedown that ended the round at all. Like, it was, you know, a random takedown from early in the round that the dude just popped right back up from. So it wasn't the one that stole the round for Healy. It was, you know, it was a random one that happened. So, I mean, it's like Baroni is completely lost there. And then he's more concerned, other than trying to sound good while he's giving the color commentary, which, I mean, that's just the absolute wrong position to have him in anyway.
Oh.
He should be third mic for a commentary team if they're going to have him at all, because they need, you know, they need the color guy. They need the, you know, they need, like, the Goldie and the Rogan, and he can be, like, the peanut gallery that tosses in something every now and then. But he was having trouble running down, like, the keys to victory for each fighter, you know? And, I mean,
yeah.
They've got to have it on a card in front of him or on a teleprompter, and he's still, it's like he doesn't know how to read, you know? He's got to keep standing. And, you know, the other guy's got to bring him to the ground.
Is a wrestler, and, you know, he wants to keep it, I mean, blah, blah, and he wants to take it to the ground.
Yeah, you know. And that's the other thing, too, that I love the only thing, actually, that I love about Baroni is the fact that he sounds like a goddamn cartoon character from the city. Okay, like, it's almost like his voice is a put-on, because that's how, he's like, yeah, you know, this guy, he's got some good stand-up, but I think he's got some ground skills, too, so,
don't
you know, I
don't
think he'll be all right.
Hands.
So, you know, this is the type of fight I like to see, where guys show some nuts and guts. That was his entire
that's thing, dude.
Like,
he loves
he
nuts and guts.
Yeah?
He loves it. He loves saying nuts and guts.
Yeah. Well, and then, you know, the other dude says to him, ah, you're going to trademark that one, huh, Phil? And,
the guy's getting sick of his guts. The guy fucking hates his guts. He should have said, I hate your guts.
Yeah, exactly. So
I think it was a different second mic this time, too, because if I remember correctly, in the first one, it was some Australian guy who was probably like, I can't fucking work with this sweaty animal anymore. I'm not coming back for the second time, okay? I just can't sit next to this guy and just go, oh, it's a nut splitter.
It's a nut splitter.
Oh, man. Well, the best was, like I said, I watched the chick fight.
Mm-hmm.
We're basically two unknown chicks. One of the girls trains with Gil Melendez, I believe her name is Colleen Schneider and stuff, who I'm now friends with on Twitter and everything. So, you know, which is nice. Because I congratulated her on her win. But as she's coming out, you know, she's an all right looking girl. But then Phil goes, oh, she's got quite a hot little body on her. He goes,
Ah, Phil. There you go.
He just couldn't resist. You know, he's supposed to be a professional sitting there, and of course, you know, obviously we're not blind. I know I've made these comments, like, when with the outfit Ronda Rousey was and everything, but this guy's actually commentating, and there's woman fighters coming out to go to war, and he goes, oh, she's got quite a little body on her.
What a jerk off. I mean, it's one thing for, you know, you sitting around with your friends around the TV making all sorts of retarded comments, or the two of us sitting here to make retarded comments like that, you know, but for the guy who's being paid to provide color commentary on the fight, sitting at ringside to say about,
oh, look, coming down.
Yeah,
and
that's
they try to regroup around her, and you know, and she hasn't really fought that much, but the thing is, she's able to keep it in that kind of shape because she's just constantly training throughout the year. She just doesn't stop.
Because I guess you realize
bring
weight
around
that.
There. You see that?
She was
I'm sorry, I sounded like a fucking pole gorilla. I'm gonna have to try to come back to some sort of relevant stuff to say. I talk good. She's more gooder because she trains all the time.
Exactly.
And then apparently, like, the girl, the girl Colleen, she went and got her degrees in, like, physics and fucking, like, astrophysics and stuff and decided to be a fighter. And that was the only thing that when it was like, well, you know, so, I mean, you could tell she's a tough girl, very victim. And Phil, this was one Phil got right. He goes, well, I got to actually say I disagree with her decision. He goes,
let's see, I'm going to be a rocket scientist or I'm going to get punched in the face for a living.
The choice is easy.
Yeah, exactly. I had to agree with Phil there. I was like, well, you got one right, Phil. You're 100% right. Why not get punched in the face for a living and make a decent amount of money? I don't even know really where you go for that kind of work or whatever, but I'm sure it pays well.
Yeah, well, you know, I mean, Phil being right, a sun shines on a dog's ass every now and then. So, I mean, he has to get one every now and then. So.
Oh, that's true. And he got that one because he was, well, I definitely disagree with that. But, you know.
Well, you should know, too, because, you know, yeah, he's still getting paid to get punched and you know, he's not good at his job. So.
No, well, you know, he's 500, Billy. That's not terrible. You know, I think he might actually be 17 and 15 now. And, you know, he's certainly got a couple wins under his belt since he left. But I believe he slid right into this cushy gig at Super Fight League because this is what he wants to do, you know, when fighting is done. So Joe Rogan, as I've said before, after the first Super Fight League event, now that Phil Brony's got two under his belt, it's only a matter of time before the UFC comes calling and just fire Joe Rogan.
Oh, yeah. Because I can totally see that mushmouth gorilla taking over Rogan's spot. I mean,
absolutely.
You know, as much as we've been complaining about Rogan in the last couple of weeks about how much of a nut hugger he's seemed to become, you know, the guy is very knowledgeable, and at least the guy speaks and is intelligent most of the time. Whereas Phil Baroni, you know, he's about two chromosomes away from throwing his own shit. So,
well, you know, hey, he came out of the gates on fire. He just cooled off quite a bit in his illustrious career. But don't fret anybody if you didn't see it live this time or haven't watched the replay. Super Fight League 3 is already being put together. Phil Baroni will be back as color commentator. I'm sure they'll have another guy sitting ringside with him because this guy probably hated his guts as well. And, let me get to music and I'll and hold on a second and I'll tell you what the main event is going to be.
Okay.
Here, we'll let it build up, you know.
When that guitar riff hit, I'm expecting a Rocky montage.
Pow, punch, kick, wow. Drop us to the mat with the push now. Super Fight!
I would love to sing with a different leg, but it turns out right.
Fight, I gotta fight!
fight, cause it's in his blood. Fight, I gotta fight in the ring of the mud. Fight, I gotta fight for the opportunity, and the beast of the fight to victory. Fight, I gotta raise his hand. Fight, I gotta take that chance. Fight, I gotta be paid of adrenaline. Fight, I gotta win. Fight, I gotta win. Fight, I gotta win.
Well, the main event that's going to be headlining the next Super Fight card is, I believe you'll remember him from Super Fight League 1. He obviously impressed the crowd, impressed the owners when he dismantled. He hurt Bobby Sapp so bad, I didn't even see it happen. I didn't even see the injury take place. That's how bad he hurt Bob Sapp. And, you know, so James the Colossus Thompson has found a new home. He himself with a 17-15 record. Old Cauliflower Year himself, who, you know, was fed to Kimbo and was beating the balls off of Kimbo somehow when his ear popped, the fight was stopped. But, hey, whatever. You know, that's the past. This is the future. They're going to serve up James the Colossus Thompson a la gourmet to one Bobby Lashley.
Oh, that's great. What's Bobby Lashley been up to since, you know?
He's been fighting. He's on a win streak. I believe he's still only got the one loss on his record that Chad Griggs just beat the living shit out of him and showed him what it is to be a real fighter. But I'm trying to remember who fucking... Oh, it was Josh Barnett. I was looking at Josh Barnett's Twitter. And what do you call it? He said... Bobby Lashley wrote some sort of a post like knocking out haters with the power of positive thinking. And then Josh Barnett just wrote to him, he goes, knocking out with a big question mark. And he goes, don't you mean double legging? He goes, because in case anybody doesn't know who Bobby Lashley is, he's another WWE wrestler who had a real wrestling credentials and is just a giant monster, and of course he rips people down to the ground and pounds the shit out of them. So, you know, Josh Barnett was, you know, he was like, give me those ribs as you, I'm just fucking with you. But, you know, he had to make fun of him by basically saying, you're not KOing him, you're ripping him to the ground, dude. Come on, seriously. So so what do you think about that news? That's going to make for an exciting main event.
Oh, yeah. Are you kidding? Bobby Lashley also holds a win over Bob Sapp. So him and the Colossus do have something in common. So
that was another Sapp mission, I believe, when he fought. Did I tell you? They cleaned it up since, but somebody was just having a lot of fun on Bob Sapp's Wikipedia. And
yeah, you did. You said that he was now referred to as Bob the Tap Sapp, and that all, you know, any of his submission losses came from Sapp Mission.
Sapp Mission, yeah. It was fucking incredible, and I was like, wow, this is so great. I thought it was real because it was up for like 2 days. So I guess somebody finally said, "This." I had no idea what a Sapp Mission was. I told Wikipedia, and they cleaned it up, of course. But it was great. It was so great, you know, and I believe even in his, like, bio, the guy snuck something by saying he's become famous for his myriad of different ways to find how to tap out at just the right time. You know, he's just like, he became
an artist. To avoid taking damage and still be able to collect his check.
Yeah, something to that effect, and I was like, wow, I can't believe this is up on Wikipedia like this. This is really basically, like, you know, saying the guy just goes in there for a paycheck, but... He does. We all know this. I mean, that's why he miraculously recovered to go face Marius Pudzianowski next month.
Oh,
God. Yeah. Pudzianowski got to get back on that winning track, you know?
Pudzianowski is tired of strapping tractor trailers to his pits and pulling them from point A to point B.
Dude.
You know, and throwing gear kegs over walls and shit like that, you know.
Well, Timmy Sylvia gave him the old how's your father and fucking beat the balls off of him and taught him how real MMA goes. You know, that was one of the, you know, as we all know, Tim Sylvia's been begging for a job back in the UFC, but that was one of the things when he was just floating around that they signed Tim Sylvia for when I believe Pudzianowski was still undefeated. Tim was just like, I am going to fuck this dude up. And he fucked Pudzianowski up. Pudzianowski tapped because he finally got punched. It was almost like a Sapp mission. So, but yeah, so Super Fight League 3 is coming. And then, you know, I know we're poking fun and, you know, we of course love the song and, you know, I can't get over the song. But no, I'm pulling for these guys to pull through. I think they're actually real big fans, and they're trying their damnedest to make this thing work. So, you know, it's not exactly an amazing main event, but you know, they keep trying to go for legit dudes. I mean, Lashley, you can't deny. I believe he's 6-1 at this point in his career, unless somebody else snuck a loss on him. He's 7-1.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so he's 7-1. You know, he's a pretty legit dude. James the Colossus Thompson. We can make a lot of jokes about the guy, but he was at one time considered one of the next big things, and then he just shit the bed all over himself. So you know, there is a possibility that this guy could dig deep and beat Bobby Lashley, even though it's not going to happen. So I can't wait to see what the rest of the card is, who they're going to go for. I'm sure they're going to target with like what they did this time, a lot of ex-UFC guys, just to keep trying to legitimize these cards and get, you know, more and more legitimacy built up, so maybe they can start getting some main talent over there. Who knows, you know? I know Fedor's not doing anything. Maybe they can get a Fedor in there for a main event.
Right now, I mean, it looks like they've already got four fights slated for that card, but I don't know any of the people on it at all. Trevor Prangley.
He's a name. I've heard him before. I believe he fought in UFC. Strikeforce, I think.
Trevor Prangley is fighting somebody named Baga Agaev. Doug Marshall is fighting Zelg Galisic, which that name sounds familiar to me.
Yeah.
And then they have another female fight on the card, Lena. I'm not even going to attempt her last name. And she's fighting Joanne Calderwood.
Wow.
Which I think Joanne Calderwood might get beasted because it's only going to be her second fight. But
yeah, I don't know why they didn't bring back any of the women from the first card or even the second. When is it scheduled for?
It looks like May 6th.
Oh, okay.
It's happening pretty soon. So maybe. Yeah, maybe nobody. Maybe the only reason James Thompson is on the card is because you know he didn't take any damage in his fight against Bob.
He just
Sapp's
dished
back,
it out,
so.
Dude, and fucked Bob Sapp's leg up. You know, I missed it. And I think maybe he punched him in his knee or some shit like that, really, really hard. And then Bob went down and fucking tapped immediately. You know, that's what I love about Bob Sapp. I started a career at UFC Undisputed 3 because you could choose fighters, and I decided, you know what? I'm going to try to make Bob Sapp legitimate. And so far, he's sitting at 12-1. So not
Oh,
so
wow. Well, look at you, making Bob Sapp actually worth something.
I know. I didn't think I could do it because there's one loss came in the first fight, and it was just textbook Bob Sapp losery. The guy was a no-name, and then we were, of course, coming up the ranks in the smaller promotions, and the guy just did what you do to Bob Sapp. You take him down, you pound him out.
Take him down, pound him out.
I mean, I tried, Billy. I was almost ripped off the joysticks on my controller. Bob Sapp had no ground defense whatsoever. I mean, this game couldn't be more accurate on how guys are in real life. Because, let me tell you something, I was fucking smoothing the stick this way and that way and this way and that way, and Bob Sapp just fucking laid there. And then, you know, it almost looked like he was going to sat-mission himself. Yeah, it looked like he was going to sat-mission and get out of it. And I was like, I can't believe this is happening. I'm supposed to be in control of this guy. And then the guy mercifully knocked him out because I would have been embarrassed if he tapped, you know? It would have been terrible. But I think I'm going to hit the break.
All right.
Sorry for my slow start, brother. I wasn't feeling well, and my fucking computer was having issues, so I apologize for that. So I'm going to try to, you know, ramp it up. Second half, so everybody, get ready. We're going to break, but enjoy this shit again.
Pow, punch, kick, wow, drop him to the mat with the push. Now, Super Night Beat! Fight, cause it's in his blood. Why I gotta fight in the ring in the mud? Why I gotta fight for the opportunity and the beat to
be a fight to victory. But I gotta raise his hand. But I gotta take that chance. But I gotta be made of adrenaline. But I gotta win. But I gotta win. But I gotta win.
Super
The Butcher Rock. Remember our call number 347-326-9741, I believe. 347-326-9741. That's what I believe it is. What's up, brother?
Oh, you know, just restarting the computer. It decided to, not respond anymore. Yeah. So.
Yeah, I don't know. It fucking happens, man. I don't know. There's been a lot of technical problems, but I have no clue. You know, it's been another shit. It really has. So, this is why what we're going to have to start doing, I think, is say, fuck this, okay? Figure out a way to just do our own podcast and put that out.
Oh. You know,
this
oh.
Way. You know?
Oh.
That's what I'm thinking. I've been talking to Dean about it because, shit just doesn't, first off, you know, without all the other crap, it just doesn't seem to fucking work. You know, like right now the chat room, I think, is down. I don't know how to fix it.
Really?
Looking at it right now. Yeah, you got chat.
I had actually posted something else in the chat room, and I was surprised you didn't actually reference it.
I clicked it before the chat got all screwy. I don't know if it's back yet. It looks like it's back, but I don't see you in the chat room anymore.
Well, I had to restart my computer, so that would follow.
Oh, okay. So I forgot that. But, yes, the video you did post is amazing. It's off of a certain guy we like to talk about every so often, his own YouTube account. And underneath it, before I give you the big reveal, it's somebody training in a gym. And the description they give for the video is beast mode. And it's none other than the one, the only, the maniac, Tim Sylvia. I believe he posted this to YouTube when he was going through that campaign trying to fucking convince the UFC to put him in an event, upcoming event. And obviously, I don't see how they did not get back to him and say yes, because this motherfucker starts out, and the video starts out with him jumping rope. Like, I've never seen a human being jump rope before. I mean, this is sick. This is sick. Rocky's got nothing on good old Timmy boy here. And he immediately throws the jump rope down. He saunters. He pretends like he's running, but he saunters over to the free weights, and he's doing something that I can't do, so I'm not going to make fun of him. He's just curling up. I believe it looks like how much of the bar weigh again, Billy?
He's got a total of 150 pounds there. He's got 45 pound plates on each side, and the bar itself is about 50 to 55 pounds.
Okay.
So yeah, he's got about 145 pounds on that bar.
All right. Well, I'm not gonna make fun of that part because I can't do that. Okay. He's just curling that and then just picking it up over his head, bringing it down like all, and in like a nice motion. Okay. But then he starts kneeling and then jumping on a box, which I know I can do that. I'd blow my knees out, but hey, I can do it. Sweating like a son of a bitch.
Then he does push-ups.
Yeah, that's where we're at right now in the video, girl push-ups. And as far as I'm concerned, last time I checked, those don't count, okay? Like, if you're going and you have a test, and it's a type of physical test like this, and you do girl push-ups, you fail. That's what I thought happened. But who am
I to say? He tries to make them interesting by slightly lifting his hands up when he finishes.
Right.
You know, but it's still, he's got his knees on the ground.
Yeah, it's absurd. I don't know how he thinks that is good, but I don't know. You know, maybe when you're 6'8", you can't do push. I don't know. You know, I can't do one push-up right now, so I shouldn't make fun of this fat bastard. Jimmy only looked like he was about 370 there, so no prop cutting 265.
Unreal.
Yeah. Right there. There's another Tim. There's one with just his fat head on it, and this is him campaigning, I guess, to be back to the UFC.
I didn't get it off of Timmy's YouTube page. I got it off a page that was making fun of him.
You know what I'm going to try to do? This might crash the whole show, but okay. I'm going to try to play this. I'm going to see if I can rip this and put it on the show while we're on. I've never done this before because, as I have explained, nothing but technical glitches on this godforsaken thing. But I'm going to try to attempt to do this because this is great. This is him begging for his job back in UFC. So let's see if I can get this on there. But, yeah, no, Timmy's impressive. You know, he's on a win streak. You can't deny him that.
What is he on, like a 5-fight win streak now or something like that?
4 or 5, yeah, you know. According to Dana, he hasn't seen Timmy fight since he got knocked the fuck out by Ray Mercer, which he's just saying that to hurt Timmy's feelings. I know it. But apparently the UFC doesn't like Timmy.
Oh, well, what are you going to do? Yeah.
So we'll see if I can make magic tonight. I've never done this. We'll see. So, you know, good for Timmy. If you got any more workout videos for Tim, please throw them up.
I'll have to take a look to see if there's any more, gold out there. Because I watched that and I was just like, oh my goodness, this is a man who's supposed to be an athlete. Now, granted, you know, yes, you're absolutely right. The workout that he's doing right now would probably kill you and me right now.
Oh, absolutely,
okay?
It would.
Back when we were young and actually did some of this stuff, it's laughable compared to even the little bit of training we used to do when we played football. But, so when you think that he's supposed to be a professional athlete, what he's doing is absolutely hysterical. You know, yes, I get winded watching him as a fat bastard who sits on my couch and watches professional athletes, but... I feel safe in making fun of him as compared to other people who are supposed to get paid to do what he does. And,
sure.
Yes. I do love how his wife or whoever it is barking orders at him from behind the camera. Completely, at least pretending to be some sort of a trainer. And he has absolutely no sense of urgency or he's in no rush to get from station to station. Let's put it that way.
Yeah.
I find that hysterical, too.
Yeah, so. I think that's the best part of the whole thing, is that he is certainly in no rush. And let's see here.
And that, you're right. This was posted when he was actively campaigning to get a fight in the UFC, even if he had to do it for free. So, and this is what he decided, yeah, this is going to get me hired again, showing me in beast mode. And like I said, for my fat ass, when I actually did a little bit of training, back when, I played football, I could totally do everything that he was doing. And I'm talking everything, even, the stupid, 145-pound curls and then putting it up over my head. You put a little more weight on that, I wouldn't have been able to. But, I think the guy who I stole the video from, his comment was, my wife can curl more than that.
Fuck yeah. I don't know if I can. I'm pretty gross.
Oh, right now, no. Are you kidding? I completely throw my back out. Because that's the other thing, too, that I was actually, as an armchair athlete, critiquing his form. Because when he's doing those curls, he's completely fucking his back up. Because he's throwing it up. He's throwing it up with his back. He's not using his arms. Okay? He's chucking it up to his chest using his back. So... He's not even training properly. I mean, you can laugh at the exercises that he's doing, but he's not even doing them correctly. He's actually it's like he's actively trying to hurt himself instead of improve himself,
which is hysterical. I mean, if a professional athlete like him did hurt himself doing basic exercises, you got to laugh at that. That's funny.
It would have been a much better video if that's how it ended, actually. You know, I mean, it's hysterical in its current form. But, yes, if it all of a sudden he was just like, out in the back, that would have been great. And I would have absolutely jumped on the bandwagon for him to get his job back in the UFC if he still posted it after hurting himself. So,
well, I got to be honest, though. I don't know how. I mean, this is the sheer hatred that they have for him. Yeah, it knows no bounds, because to offer to fight for free for a chance, you know, I don't know how they just don't go, all right, sure, free. You know, I'm probably wasting all my time right here, because it's probably not even interesting. I bet you he says nothing all that interesting. So I'm probably wasting my time, even if this does work. So get ready, everybody, to be let down completely.
Complete and utter letdown.
Complete and utter letdown. But you know what?
That's what we offer here.
Right. This is what we're offering, and I really don't give a shit, because this way I know I can do these things while I'm on the air without crashing the system. Or I'm going to find out right now if the system crashes, don't ever do this again. You know?
So and then if we go to a hard out at, 5 to 11, then we're good. You know,
right.
Just know not to do it again.
Right. And if we go to a hard out, suck my balls. That's all I'm going to say about that. My balls need a little bit of whitewashing. So, please. Oh, wait, no, not whitewashing. Brings up a whole other thing going on. So, now let's see. Let me jump over here to us. Let's see if it showed up here anywhere. Let's see. I might have to reload the room, which will probably cut us off, so I probably can't do this.
Oh, no.
Yeah. If I was still connected and I didn't get thrown off the fucking show before, this probably would have worked, actually.
Ah,
the other number disconnected. I have a workaround.
Oh.
I have a workaround. Here we go, I think. This is so uninteresting, but I don't give a shit. Uh-oh. Still there, brother?
Yeah. I'm here.
Oh, shit. I thought I just killed us, because I'm now... I did get to the workaround, but I don't think we're going to be able to play it.
Oh, really?
Yes. It's probably not all that important anyway. It was probably a waste of time, all this build-up and everything. You know... It's a waste of time. All right, let's see if we get disconnected. Are we still there?
I still hear you. I don't know if that means anything.
Well, we're probably just talking to ourselves, but that's okay. That's okay.
Oh, hold on. Let me turn on the audio real quick, because I usually have us muted in the background.
Yeah.
Oh, my God, that's us from the past right there.
Oh, I know. That's what I'm saying. There's a delay. That's why I didn't want to sing along with the Super Fight League song.
Punch, kick, wow.
Punch, kick, wow. Super Fight League! Uh-oh. All right. Things are still working. That's good to know.
I guess all right. Cool. So then what's next on the agenda, then? You know, if it's not going to work.
Oh. I feel like garbage. I was just going to lay down and let you fucking just go with it.
Oh, jeez. Are you kidding?
Yeah. No, I'm not. It's all you here. There's really not much to talk about. I mean, we could talk a little bit about... we already talked about Chael and... Oh, yeah. Yeah, you know. Nick Diaz will be fighting, but only in a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu tournament.
Yeah.
Coming up today.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so, that's interesting. He's going to be fighting Bruno Estima.
Okay.
I don't really know how to pronounce it because the guy's Brazilian, but it's going to be at the World Jiu-Jitsu Expo. So, obviously, the fire still burns for Nick, and he still wants to compete out there, and he's going against one of the best in the world. And, there's no guarantee he'll win that, but the other interesting thing is I read that they have lawyered a defense, they have hired a defense team to go in and hash out things with the Athletic Commission in Nevada with Nate's suspension. So I'm going to assume that they're going to try to get that overturned and overruled. So I guess Nick probably isn't going to be retiring, which is probably good news.
Well, yeah, I'm definitely glad to hear that he's not going to be, you know, I would definitely want to see him fight again. He's always interesting to watch. You know, he's a fighter that always comes forward. You know, he's got a pretty good jits game. You know, and by pretty good, I mean awesome.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, great hands. He's a great, yeah, he talks a lot of shit. He's always interesting, you know, he's always got the I want to kill you face on. You know, so he's one of those guys that I enjoy watching. So when he said after his last fight that he was done, I was really hoping he wasn't, because he's one of those guys that I pay to see fight.
Absolutely. I mean, he's always entertaining. But you know what? I'm sorry to cut you off there. But you know what? I really can't blame him. You know, I really can't blame him. And I know, you know, I was joking around with the Barnett thing. Obviously, you know, he has fucking, you know, done shit like with the four banned substances in the system. And then, of course, showing up positive again. Similar situation at Overeem, you know, when that shit happened in California when it blew apart the Affliction fight card and stuff. But, you know, Nick, this is just for pot, something that he has, a medical reason to be smoking it anyway, you know, which, of course, is bullshit in California. Anybody can get those fucking things, and then, you know, you just walk into any fucking corner store and buy your weed, which is, you know, the way it should be. But, you know, that should be go across the board, whether it's fucking weed, fucking heroin, cocaine. Hey, man, if you want to do it, fuck it. Who gives a fuck? But, you know, that's a different conversation.
Yeah.
But, you know, Nick has... You know, and of course, everybody's going to go, oh, well, nobody's listening to us anyway, but people are going, oh, you just fucking like the guy and you're his fan. But if you really look at a lot of the fights that he's had in Vegas, he's been screwed out of decisions a lot of the times. And you know, and it's probably his demeanor and the way he does talk to the people when he's got to talk to them and, the, you know, and shit that, you know, they feel they are really treated unfairly when they go to Nevada to fight. You know, they don't feel like they have this bias against them just about anywhere else that they go. So maybe a lot of the times they go in there and people have a chip on their shoulder about Nick. You know, that's why he got fucked with the decision. You know, maybe not. You know, of course, it's half and half or and stuff that people say Khan had definitely won that fight or not. But, you know, so they feel like they're really attacking him over the whole weed thing and blowing it out of proportion because his name happens to be Nick Diaz.
Oh, yeah, definitely. You know, it does seem odd that, you know, that he's, at least with some of the things that they brought up, it does seem like he's a bit of a target. And, yeah, he doesn't make it easier, at least in Nevada, but, you know, he doesn't make it easy for anybody because, I guess, of his attitude and the way he responds to media and people in general. I don't know. I mean, I guess maybe if he does beat this, you know, they're probably going to push for him to, you know, fight anywhere but Las Vegas, which, I mean, either way, I'm dialed in for his fights.
Oh, definitely. You know, but I mean... And the thing is, of course, that's like home base for the UFC, but with the way things are, you know, have expanded and the fact that they, you know, like going to these other countries and, you know, they're still pushing for the New York thing. I mean, there's plenty of places to try to schedule this guy. You know, they're not just in Vegas anymore, so it is a possibility. You know, as for the fact if he does beat this and not get suspended for a long period of time, you know, they can fill out the paperwork and they'll have to exempt him if marijuana shows up in a system, you know. So that's the what the NSAC's stance is that he could have submitted the paperwork and they were well aware, you know. So I don't know how if it's going to go in his way or not. I hope it does because, you know, I would rather see him in there fighting and get another chance because he's talented enough to, you know, next fight out, win, be right back in the title picture, and then put an ass-whooping on Jordan St. Pierre because, you know, it came out of his own mouth that he said he was going to put an ass-whooping on St. Pierre, and I believe him.
yeah, well, I mean, that's the other thing, too. He just constantly comes forward, and, you know, I know we all thought that he would probably give St. Pierre problems, but, you know, St. Pierre is one of those ultimate game planners, so... you never know what's going to happen.
going to happen, because that guy just seems to come up with a way to just about neutralize just about anybody's game. So, you know, I still want to see that fight, and I'm sure the UFC...
Neutralize or just bore them to death?
Well, no. I mean, I guess that's essentially what neutralize means, you know, in this case. Because, yeah, GSP went from being a killer who I wanted to watch all the time to somebody who is constantly on his bike, you know, and doesn't ever go for the kill anymore. And it's, you know, disappointing because he fights to not lose instead of fighting
exactly.
to win. And it's, you know, it doesn't make for an exciting fight. It doesn't make for an entertaining fight.
That's why, you know, look, say they got like John Jones, for instance. Obviously, you know, love him or hate him. You know, a lot of people are getting on the bandwagon saying, fuck this kid. He seems like a cocky prick. Franco was the first to say it right after he won the title. I think actually right before he won that title against Shogun, Franco did a complete 180. I think that's the proper way to say it, right? In turn.
Yeah.
Yeah,
if he said 360, he'd be back in the
He'd
same.
Be back in support of him, correct? Yeah.
Yes, exactly.
Fucking geometry. I didn't fucking pay attention, but I guess I got that one right. You know, that saying he's a cocky prick, some people are now fucking hating him. I'm not hating him, but I do believe he's buying into his own hype, and this is going to be the, if I can say this phrase, because I know a couple guys on ESPN got in trouble for saying this phrase, but I think it's okay to say it in this respect. I believe that might be the chink in his armor, because, you know, he's definitely buying into this whole greatness thing, and of course he's trying to come across and say he isn't cocky. But the difference between him and St. Pierre, like you pointed out, has become very safe. He's afraid to lose, whereas this kid keeps going forward and looking for ways to finish a fight. You know, the only time that he looked even slightly tentative and he still beat the balls off the guy was against Rampage Jackson, because he claimed he respected his knockout power. So, you know, I mean, when you see something like that, now, of course, he's a young kid. An athletic freak. It's really disappointing to see a guy like George St. Pierre, knowing what he's capable of, to keep fighting in this like safety net of fighting. You know, I mean, even when he fought Josh Koscheck, why didn't he go in for the kill against Josh when he blew his fucking orbital bone apart? You know what I mean? Like, it was there for the taking. It was obvious that the stand-up game was ridiculously better on St. Pierre's part. Josh couldn't even see to really throw his overhand right, so. You know, what was he waiting for? It was there, you know.
Absolutely.
And nobody gives St. Pierre shit. And it kind of drives me crazy, because when Anderson Silva was getting bored and fucking touring people for the sake of touring them just to keep himself interested, everybody wanted his fucking head. That, oh, he could finish that fucking guy. And he decided not to. This guy is a fucking disgrace, and he's disrespecting the sport. I mean, you remember that whole dust-up a couple years ago, which everybody now has conveniently forgotten about and licks his balls like crazy, you know? Which is fine. They should lick his balls because he is the greatest. But everybody wanted to lynch him for fucking doing it in three fights where he just sort of fucking tooled out on people to because he could. He was that much better than them. And then nobody gives fucking St. Pierre any flack for going out there being the killer that he used to be. You know, everybody's just like, yeah, but St. Pierre's great. You know, of course, you know, like fucking people who really fucking intensely follow the sport. Yeah, those people are sitting there going, this motherfucker, you know, he doesn't do shit. And I'm really getting sick and tired of him holding that strap.
Yeah, and I mean, it's a problem that you find with a lot of champions. I mean, even people... I mean, for the interim belt, let's take a look at Carlos Condit, okay? And his fight against Diaz. He definitely fought a very safe fight. You know, he was on his bike,
absolutely.
And, you know, I know that, you know, we're to open the can of worms about that fight again, where, you know, people, depending on what side of the fence they're on, you know, people arguing, oh, yeah, it was definitely all Condit, or, you know, it was all Diaz, and, except for X, Y, or Z round. Condit, who is billed as a killer, as a guy who finishes, as a guy who, you know, goes in there looking to take your head off. And instead, he was just, you know, basically Nick was running them down the entire fight. And, you know, he wasn't engaging hardly at all. I had said it actually about a couple of the Jose Aldo fights too, where he went from just a guy who was going to go out there looking to finish you, and it could happen at any moment. That I thought, like the first couple of fights in the UFC, I thought he was a little tentative. And I don't know. It's one of those things that that I think just sort of takes something away from the fight, because especially seeing as their big money matches are their title fights, if somebody decides to check in for one of these highly touted title fights, and then sees a match where somebody's just laying and praying, or just doing enough boxing and staying away just to make sure that they hold on to the belt by the end of the night, that's somebody who's probably not going to come back and watch again. And it's not something that you can sell, I don't think. That's not the exciting. I mean, all right, for instance, the little disclaimer that they have before all their Fox broadcasts now, which I think is lame as hell, but the thing that they post up saying, this may be the most intense, exciting sporting event you've ever seen in your life. Okay? And then
the service.
Yeah, exactly. It's like a public service announcement making sure that your heart doesn't stop. And you're like, oh, man, this could be fair too. And then imagine if the fight is John Fitch, who, whatever, that's the way he wins. But the dude,
the most exciting knockout artist. Oh, wait, no, that's right. He's not.
He's a guy that's going to hug up on you and take you to the ground and hold you there for three to five rounds if he can. And that's not exciting, and GSP's fights have not been exciting. So I don't know. I know you don't want to take unnecessary risks and you don't want to take unnecessary damage, but you also are out there to entertain, and people who are paying to see you, they need to be entertained.
Well, that's just it. That's why, we did try to talk about Bellator a little bit, on this show, because we said we would talk about the smaller shows, but that's why, I'm not a huge fan of a guy like Ben Askren. That's what he does. He's laying prayer. I mean, he's undefeated. He's got the title over there. But for him to sit there and even have a shot, in my opinion, for the UFC to want to come over here, he's going to have to do just a little bit more, than just that, because eventually he is going to be a free agent, because everybody's talking about that, that promotion, because there's a couple dudes coming out of there that the UFC is probably going to end up signing, Eddie Alvarez and Hector Lombard. I believe both their contracts are up this year, and those guys will probably end up in the UFC. But both those guys are exciting as hell. Even though on paper they're good enough, they're in the top 10, top 5 in most rankings and stuff. Of course, a lot of guys you see that are that high, they come into the UFC and then they have some troubles, but. The fact of the matter is, both those guys are still going to put on exciting fights. So, the guys like we're talking about, and unfortunately, George was one of those guys. He was a fucking killer, and now he's not. But, of course, hopefully at the end of this month, we're going to get ourselves a pretty exciting title fight with Rashad Evans and Johnny Jones, because both these guys want to take each other's heads off, and I think they're both going to go all out in that. I don't know if you looked at some of the numbers that go into both these guys' careers. Have you seen any of this?
I don't know. I don't think I have taken a look at it yet. No.
Well, as I think Rashad has a great shot in this fight. But after looking at these numbers, I'm starting to fucking disagree with my point that Rashad might take the title back. Because
really?
Apparently, yeah. This John Jones, who, of course, I was just saying how a lot of people are on the fence with him now, and possibly going to the other side saying they don't like him because he's a cocky prick. I think he's got every right to be a cocky prick, because I'm going to give you a few things here. Mm-hmm. John Jones' average fight length is 9.229 minutes, 9:29, so just under 9 minutes. I mean, yeah, just 9 minutes, 30 seconds, just under 9 minutes, 30 seconds. The average UFC fight, 9 minutes, 34 seconds.
Okay.
Okay, so he's finishing people on the whole average of UFC combined since he's been around since 1993, he's 5 seconds faster with his finishes than the whole UFC. And we've had some exciting finishers in the UFC. His knockdown average per 15 minutes is 0.47. UFC average, 0.29.
Okay.
Strikes landed per minute. He has 3.82 strikes landed per minute. The UFC average is 2.61. His striking accuracy, 51.9%. The UFC average is 42%. Strikes absorbed per minute, 1.42. The average UFC fighter absorbs 2.61. His striking defense is at 66.6%. The average is 58%. Okay, his strike differential, plus minus, is plus 2.4. The average is even over all the fights and everything. It's even. No, if you average everybody's fights out together, it comes up even.
Okay.
So now that's pretty intriguing. Okay. He's had his shoulders above the rest. I mean, we've seen the guy fight. We know this. But here's some more. His takedown average per 15 minutes, 3.32. The average is 1.93. His accuracy on takedowns, 63.6. The average is 41%. His defense is 100%. He's never been taken down. UFC average, 55%. And his submission attempts per 15 minutes, 1.11. Still ahead of the curve at 1.06. These are inhuman numbers. This guy is better than anybody who's ever, I mean, on paper anyway. Well, we got to see how his career keeps going. He's better than anybody who's ever put on the gloves, even before there was gloves. These are ridiculous numbers. Now, I'm not going to go through the whole shebang with Rashad because he's got some pretty impressive stats too. But let me tell you something. They pale so much in comparison to John Jones. And the only thing that Rashad has going for him is that every fighter that he's ever attempted to take down, he's taken down. But this is a different animal now. I know they sparred together. So this guy's never been taken down. So, that was the thing that I was thinking is Rashad's going to get in close, going to be able to rip him down, and possibly work the ground game. I'm starting to think that maybe Rashad doesn't have a chance in this fight because we all know he's got a suspect chin.
Yeah. Of course, there's the wonderful knockout that he took at the hands of Lyoto Machida.
Right.
And it's not like Lyoto was known for his knockout power up to that point either. Obviously – his best bet is to, get John Jones to the ground and see if he can pan him out. It's a tough match. I mean, obviously he's trying his damnedest to get into Johnny Jones's head, to see if he can at least win the mental game. We've all said, I think even you, saying that you thought he had a chance to win. You've always had reservations about it. You haven't. It's not like you've been firmly behind Rashad, at least as far as I can remember.
No.
You've always said that you thought he had the best shot.
Yes.
To take out John Jones. But it's not like you've ever said, "Yep, Rashad's winning it. That's it. Put all your money on him."
Only thing I can think of, and I started to think it more and more before I'd seen this today, was because I do believe mentally he's beating the balls off of John Jones. I don't care what Johnny says, he's definitely in his head. But if you watch like that, how they do the lead up to it, it's just, I know people saying he's cocky, but it seems like 100% confidence. When he was talking about it, because, obviously there's a lot of hurt feelings involved with the Rashad thing and the way John Jones, sorry, I got you off there. John Jones put it, he said, I'm actually really happy that Rashad's coming in angry with a chip on his shoulder because it's going to not enable him to do the things he's going to do And the second part of the equation is me. I ain't going to let him do what he wants to do. He goes, what I'm going to do is break his spirit and his will and show him that he just wasted 3 months of his life because there's no way he can beat me, you know. And it didn't seem like he was being a cocky prick. It just seemed like supreme confidence when he said it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And then this came out today, this article, and I was looking at these stats going, holy shit. You know, I knew the fucker was inhuman and good and possibly one of the best we've ever seen, but this is crazy, you know, because he's fought some high-level wrestlers in that cage, you know. And if those guys can't take him down, I mean, Ryan Bader is a very high-level wrestler, you know, and a very strong dude, and he made him look like a fucking infant. When Bader got a hold of him, he threw him around.
Yeah. Well, hey, you know, I guess we'll get to see. But, I don't know. But it's interesting. I mean, the whole fact that they used to train together. So Rashad has a decent idea of what he does do. Granted, he's improved and probably grown as a fighter, especially, you know, since Rashad left camp and no longer trains with him. You know, I'm sure he's not the same exact fighter that Rashad knew. Rashad's playing the mental game pretty well, you know, and the fact that, just the fact that you brought up that Rashad has taken down pretty much, I think he's has scored the most takedowns that any light heavyweight has ever scored, ever.
Okay. I believe they're 1 and 2 on the list. It's actually in here. Yeah, I think you're right. I think he has the most takedowns ever, and then John Jones is right behind him.
Yeah. So, so I think he's, you know, even though he's not the elite wrestler, you know, he was still a pretty damn good one, and apparently, you know, good enough to take down pretty almost anybody he wants to. So we'll see. We'll see if John Jones continues to prove to be the inhuman beast that he's being billed as, or if Rashad has his number. I think it's interesting. I'm pulling for Rashad just because, of course, you know, you like that kind of story. But I personally think that John Jones is going to win. You know, that's what I think the safe money is on, which is, I think, why I want to see Rashad win, because I think it would be the more interesting outcome.
Oh, absolutely. Things blow up. I mean, things go crazy if Rashad wins.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. You know? Not to mention, I think it would be better for John Jones in the long run to have the loss now. After having the best year that any MMA fighter has ever had, ever, I think it would be a good idea to sort of knock him down, you know, for him to get knocked down a peg now than say, you know, go on a tear and be unstoppable for another year and then have somebody else, you know, knock him down. Because I think, I think now it would probably be a little bit better for him, you know, maybe easier to recover from to have happen now.
Sure.
Than say after feeling invincible for another year or so, you know?
Well, I mean, we all know Matt Hamill beat him, so he has tasted defeat before. Oh, wait. Oh, wait. He's fucking going to murder him. And then all of a sudden somebody stepped in and saved the hammer and disqualified John Jones. That's right. He was fucking murdering that guy. I feel horrendous. I apologize. I'm shitty tonight, brother. I don't know what's wrong with me.
All right. Well, hey, if you want to call it early, I mean, we're only 10 minutes early.
I know that. So. I know. I'm debating. I'm debating because you know, we still got a few minutes here. I mean, obviously, there's really not that much. See, this is what happens. I'm not feeling well. For one, for starters.
Mm-hmm.
Zero MMA news. You know what we should have done right off the bat, even though when I was getting pissed off, I couldn't focus because my mouse wasn't working and shit. We probably should have just started talking wrestling, and that would have gotten the whole fucking thing going. You know what I mean? Like, that always seems to work and put some fire into maybe even when I'm not feeling it and shit, you know? And that's where I screwed up. I was sitting here fighting with the computer, and then, you know, it just sort of tripped me up. So what we should have talked about was the huge ruckus that went on Raw this fucking Monday.
I did see that. I didn't watch it live, obviously. I YouTubed it.
Neither did I.
But I saw that. And you know what? It was sort of old school in a way, you know, because,
walking across the ropes, old school, or you mean old school wrestling?
Old school wrestling.
Oh, okay, good, good.
Okay.
Because,
John Laurinaitis, who I don't even really know who that is, he's apparently one of the guys that instead of Mr. McMahon or somebody else running things, he's the on-screen general manager now, you know, and he came out and brought out Brock, and Brock comes out and, you know, first words out of his mouth are he's thanking John Laurinaitis, who's apparently a heel, because even though everybody popped for Brock when he came out, when he says, "Oh, I just want to thank John Laurinaitis," and everybody's like, "Ah, for bringing legitimacy back to the WWE." As soon as he finishes the sentence, Cena's music hits, you know, and he comes down in his stupid green shirt and his stupid green hat, and comes down to a chorus of mixed boos with, you know, the kids and the women cheering and, you know, all the men and the smart fan booing him. And he just basically comes in. He doesn't even grab a mic. Walks up to the next big thing slaps him in the chops. What does Brock do? Brock grabs a double leg and puts him on the ground and starts patting him out. something that they don't do that often, the entire locker room clears out and hits the ring to tear these two dudes apart, with all the faces, you know, pulling Cena into one corner and all the bad guys pulling Brock into another corner. And, you know, they had
a bad guy now?
You know what? I think they're trying. The thing is that John Cena is supposed to be the top face in the company,
even though
you know, he's equally loved and hated. He's supposed to be the main good guy in the company. So that automatically makes Brock the heel. All right. Even if he's going to get cheered more than the good guy, he's the bad guy in the equation.
Right. Of course.
So, you know, he's also the guy who's attacking his opponent, you know, unprovoked. So that's the bad guy thing to do, you know. And I think they had to be separated four times, you know. Like, each time you thought they'd calm down a bit, next thing you know, they go rushing across the ring at one another, you know, until finally the bad guys dragged Brock out of the ring underneath the ropes and, you know, brought him to the back as Cena's got a mouthful of blood, which I thought was kind of cool, you know, because Brock's not exactly known for his mic work, except for when he's bad-mouthing Frank Mir or sponsors. He's not exactly known for his mic skills. So I think they're better off using him, having him throw punches at people more than talk.
Absolutely. But you know what I love when Brock was working the mic, Billy? His statement. And you know what? It couldn't have been truer, because honestly, he said, you know, he's bringing John Laurinaitis, who I want to fill you in, happens to be the brother of Joseph Laurinaitis, who's also Animal from the Road Warriors, okay? So that's who John Laurinaitis is, okay? John Laurinaitis is the younger brother of Joseph Laurinaitis and I forget the other brother's name, but Laurinaitis is also Joseph's son is James Laurinaitis, linebacker from the St. Louis Rams, so everybody knows. So this is an athletic family. Athletic fucking family. But no, anyway, I got off track there. What Brock said was how he's bringing legitimacy back to the WWE, and he's a smart man because when he was here, he was champion of the WWE, and he brought this company to heights it had never seen before, which I was like, fuck yeah, Brock, because who the fuck is Hulk Hogan? okay, first of all, okay, and second of all,
who the
then,
hell is The Rock?
Right, who the fuck is The Rock? Stone Cold Steve Austin? Suck a dick, okay,
never
because
heard of
you
him.
Did nothing. Undertaker? Suck balls. And I'm not a huge Undertaker fan, but you got to give the man his props, okay? And then he proceeded to say how he also was in the UFC and brought that company to heights I'd never seen before. And I was like, yeah, exactly. Exactly. And he was actually probably, you know, now I'm not going to say 100% right about that, but he's got some stake to claim there because he has had the largest pay-per-views the company has ever seen. So that one I'll give him a point for because he definitely helped. Even though the machine was already running for the UFC to get to this point, he sort of fucking jettisoned it. So I'm going to give him a point there. But the other one, I really, you know, I think he's got to check his wrestling history, which I know Brock don't give a fuck about. He just cares about getting money, so he probably doesn't even know who Hulk Hogan is.
I'm pretty sure he probably is aware of the existence of Terry Bollea. So,
you think he knows who Terry Bollea is?
He might not know that that's actually Hulk's name.
Okay. All right.
Although he does know The Undertaker's real name. So,
because
he loves
real
to call him Mark Calloway.
He does always refer to him as Mark. I never heard him use his full name.
Well, around the time that there was that heat when you know him and when he got in the Undertaker basically kind of got in his face. He apparently had given an interview saying, look, you know, it's not like I'm going to go back there. So why doesn't he go ahead, lace up the gloves, get in the ring with me? Because he knows, you know, he knows he can't do that. He's like, Mark Calloway would have no shot in hell, and he knows that. So.
Yeah, well, that's because he's 70, though. Come on, seriously. You know, let's fucking call a spade here. I mean, if The Undertaker, you know, the guy has actually trained mixed martial arts for, I think, like 25 years, but he's like 100 years old.
Yeah.
You know, that's why he started wearing the gloves to the fucking wrestling ring, because he wanted some connection with the sport, you know. Damn right. We got about a minute and a half left, brother. But, no, it was actually pretty cool. Like you said, both locker rooms empty. I was happy to see the sex machine, Mark Henry, out there trying to hold Brock back, which I thought he would have an easy time, considering he's the world's strongest man, according to him. And
actually, that's Mario Pudzianowski.
Well, yes, exactly. You know, and that's why Mark Henry shouldn't be saying things of such a thing. So I hope it goes back to being the sex machine gimmick or whatever it was.
Sexual chocolate.
You know, sexual chocolate, thank you. I don't know how I could forget that. It was one of the best gimmicks ever. But I guess I'm going to wrap it up because we're running low on time. Anything else, Ross?
No, that's all I got, and it wasn't much.
No, I apologize for being spotty. It's my fucking head's all fucked up and shit. So anyway, everybody... Remember to check out Roto Experts. Check out thexlog.com. Go to Bill's Twitter.
BillBrown1777.
Right. Steve, I'm going to promote it anyway, even though he fucking hates us and doesn't show up anymore. CaptainSolo07 at Twitter. Myself, Cauliflower4Ear at Twitter. And that's really about it. I think we're going to fucking get it done, Ski, because... I don't know. I'm running out of time. I know I'm going to get cut off here, but I'm just scrolling. Oh, I can't find it. Oh, here we go. All right, people.